And let's get to healthcare. I know this is very much on your mind right now. Today, you and three of your colleagues came out in opposition to the bill as released today. First of all, have you read the entire bill? I have a copy here. It's more than 140 pages, and it's very, very, I got to tell you, I tried to get through it myself. It's very complex.
It's not going to win any Pulitzer Prizes for reading, I can tell you that. I'm about a third of the way through it, and I'll be through it by the weekend. But, you know, I proposed all along we should have a Read the Bills Act, which says for every 20 pages of text, there should be one day, one working day, a Monday through a Friday, to evaluate the bill. Because I think we do need more time to be able to read and get through it. Because it's not a matter of just reading it. If you've read through these things, you're reading it and then referencing it to other parts of the federal code. So it takes a while. We have a dozen people, half a dozen people or more, reading it in my office. But I will also read it personally. I got it this morning and have not made it all the way through it yet.
Yeah, it's not easy reading, I got to tell you. All right, your Democratic colleague, Senator Chris Murphy of Connecticut, he said today that any Republican opposition to this bill, in his words, is merely prescripted political theater. This is what he tweeted. Senate will try to follow House script. One, Senate R's Act concern. Two, pass meaningless amendments. Three, claim bill is fixed. Four, fall in line. Is your opposition to this bill political theater?
Well, Senator Murphy and I do a lot of things together on some issues, but on this, you know, we disagree. My opposition has been principled in the sense that I think that the marketplace works better. I think freedom works better than coercion. And I think the federal government shouldn't be giving any money to insurance companies. Insurance companies made $15 billion in profit last year. The new Republican bill will give them $110 billion to bring down prices. But to me, that's sort of a ludicrous economic concept. That would be like telling America new cars cost too much, so we're going to have a stabilization fund so your new car will cost less, or food costs too much, or any number of things, education, and we're going to subsidize the cost to bring it down. It sort of ignores the fact that our annual budget is $500 billion in debt. I don't know how we're going to pay for all this new spending.
Listen to what the president told voters about his health care vision when he was out on the campaign trail.
Save Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security without cuts.
I'm not going to cut Medicare or Medicaid.
You're going to end up with great health care for a fraction of the price.
He wants this Senate version to have no cuts in Medicaid, but there are hundreds of billions of dollars potentially in cuts that have been included. So is the president keeping his promise?
Well, I think the thing that we have to examine about Medicaid expansion is I think that under Obamacare, it was dishonest accounting, because what we did is we expanded it to a lot of new people, maybe 12 million new people, but we paid for it all at the federal government level, and really nothing at the federal government level is really paid for. We borrow the money. We're $500 billion in the hole. We had trouble funding traditional Medicare, Medicaid, food stamps, and Social Security before we expanded into Obamacare. There isn't enough money up here for everything, and I think we just need to be honest with the American people. If people want Medicaid expansion, the most honest way is to say the state should pay for it, and then the states will have to raise taxes. And then people will get a very visible trade-off. In Kentucky, we have 450,000 new people on Medicaid. It should completely be a state function. The federal government shouldn't be expanding it, and the state should say, we've got to pay the traditional percentage we pay if we want to do this. But the governor has told me, and everybody in the legislature has told me, they don't have enough money. So really, we're just not being honest. We want things from government, but we don't want to pay the taxes for them.
Senator, you're a physician. Do you support Obamacare's mandate to cover pre-existing conditions? Because this bill won't necessarily cover treatment for pre-existing conditions, because it allows states to waive the federal mandate on what insurers must cover, known as essential health benefits. This could potentially mean that you can cover a person with cancer, but not necessarily pay for that person's chemotherapy. You support that?
I think in all likelihood, actually, this bill largely keeps the pre-existing clause that was in Obamacare. But we have to realize, and this is where we have to sort of have a big heart and also use our brain as well. The death spiral of Obamacare is because we tell people you can buy insurance after you get sick. But then we add regulatory burden, those essential health benefits that raise the cost. So if I'm a working guy in the United States and I make $30,000 a year, but because of the additional regulatory problems that my insurance costs $10,000, and you tell me, oh, you can buy it also after you get sick, Nobody's going to buy insurance. People are smart enough to avoid buying insurance. That's what happened. That's the death spiral that is Obamacare. That's one of my points about not supporting this bill is actually I think it keeps the pre-existing condition, keeps the regulations, and then subsidizes the death spiral. That's my real complaint. We are not fixing Obamacare. The problems of Obamacare will remain and may get worse, but we're going to dump a bunch of taxpayer money that's going to wind up in the coffers of very, very wealthy insurance companies.
Very quickly, will this bill pass?
Not in its existing form. And that was the point of coming out early. There's four of us, can't pass. Could pass if they'll work with us. We want to sit down with them across the table with leadership, and we want to negotiate a better bill.
All right, Senator Rand Paul, thanks.